Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here and to present my work on the effect of stress on economic decision making, which is co-authored with Johannes Haushofer as well as Drs. Mossau and Ndete. Okay, so to kind of motivate this project, we're really thinking about kind of this idea that there's a poverty trap underlying the field of economic development. I think it's no surprise to anyone in this room. But what we're really interested in is the idea that there might be a behavioral poverty trap that contributes towards the persistence of poverty, right? So the idea of a poverty trap is poverty affects decision making in ways that further perpetuate poverty. And so what we're really interested in is this mechanism of psychological outcomes as contributing to this cycle. And so many people, including many in this room, have done work on this. But what we're really focusing in on is kind of this pathway, the pathway between psychological outcomes and economic decision making. And in particular, we're going to be focusing on the channel of stress, which is kind of part of this scarcity mindset story where we think there's some sort of a poverty trap, and we're really focusing on stress as a particular channel. And so I should say up front that stress is inherently a very tricky concept. It's subjective, and so typically it's defined as when an organism's environmental demand exceed its ability to cope. So just kind of the nature of stress makes it difficult because it is inherently subjective. So why do we focus on stress? Well, stress, there's a lot of evidence. I think it's both intuitively appealing, and there's evidence that stress can contribute towards this pathway. So for example, thinking about the link between poverty and stress, well, there's extensive evidence that poverty alleviation programs may reduce stress. So I'm thinking about evidence coming from cash transfer programs, rainfall shocks, and health insurance that show that these poverty alleviation programs, policies can decrease stress through self-reported stress and cortisol. In addition, poverty is highly correlated with stress, right? And so I think in terms of that first pathway between poverty and stress, there's extensive evidence. And in terms of like the second pathway, but the channel between stress and outcomes, there's a lot of evidence coming from the psychological literature that shows that yes, stress affects decision making. So admittedly, most of this work has been done outside of economics, but they're really focusing on outcomes like memory, cognitive ability, and a variety of tasks. So they do like a lot of anagrams, analogies, or proofreading tasks. And this literature goes way back and is very well developed. So for us, what we're going to focus on, because I've titled this paper Economic Decision Making, we're really focusing on temporal discounting. So the reason that we're focusing on time preferences or temporal discounting is it's intuitively appealing, right? So this idea of temporal discounting is it captures a decrease in the subjective value of a reward when a reward is delayed. Basically, the idea is I would rather take less money now versus more money later because I just really value the present or sooner periods differently. And I think it's intuitively appealing for development economics because, of course, we think it affects economic decision making, right? If I value the future less, I'm less likely to invest in it. And so we think it's linked to a variety of outcomes, including health, education, investments, and profitable investments. And so I think there's also evidence that this is not just present or important, but it is a barrier because we've seen through Ashraf et al. And Duflo et al. That people actually exhibit a demand for commitment that can only make sense if not only is there kind of a barrier due to temporal discounting, but people are self-aware of it. And so that's why in this presentation, I'm gonna focus on temporal discounting. So where we try to step in, and so we are admittedly not the first to think about this, is that when we look at the literature coming from both economics and psychology, there's a lot of mixed evidence regarding the effects of stress, both on time preferences, so kind of I've listed a variety of papers that actually look at time preferences, but also other outcomes, so risk preferences, social preferences, competitiveness. And so when we look at this literature as a whole, one of the biggest problem, or I guess that concerns with the literature, is that people are using a wide variety of stress induction techniques, right? Stress is inherently subjective, there's different types of stress, and they're varying widely both in their method used and also in the the measure, the precise measurement of outcomes, right? I think a lot of people know here there's a lot of ways to measure time preferences. And so that's kind of, when we look at this literature as a whole, it feels messy, and it's because everyone's doing things that are different and hard to precisely compare. And so our contribution is really, I should also add, that most of these papers are coming from higher income contexts, where we're thinking of college students or adults in high income countries. Okay, and so especially when we're thinking about this behavioral poverty trap, it's especially important to think about lower income settings. And so we're contributing in I think a couple ways. First, I think we're one of the first researchers to really look at how does stress affect economic decision making in a lower income context. So we're working in Kenya with the Busara Center using individuals from slums or informal settlements. The second thing is we're actually implementing multiple methods of stress induction, right? So if our critique of the literature is that everyone's using different methods, we're actually using multiple methods of stress induction that have been well validated and designing it in a way that it's directly comparable, both in payments and kind of design. The third is we're also going to look at a variety of outcomes. So due to the limitations of time, today I'm going to focus on time preferences, but you know, in full disclosure, we look at risk preferences, time preferences, self-efficacy, so kind of a belief in oneself, as well as executive control, which captures cognitive ability. Okay? And then the last thing which we do, which I think is also an important contribution, is that we differentiate between acute and chronic stress. So right, when we think about stress, the psychological and biological literature has long distinguished from the fact that short-term stress, this acute, temporary stress, has very different physiological effects than chronic stress, which we're thinking of longer term. And so especially if we're thinking about this like behavioral poverty trap, really what we're interested in is chronic stress, which, you know, admittedly is hard to causally identify. And so we're going to attempt, I'm going to put in quotations chronic, we're going to attempt to mimic chronic stress using this setting. Okay, so this is apparently the Busara session. So I run this experiment at the laboratory, it's a laboratory experiment at the Busara Center for Behavioral Economics. I always like to point out with these pictures, so this is the lab itself, is we really are thinking of a more traditional laboratory experiment rather than lab in the field. So participants come in, they're at these stations where they can't view each other, and they're doing these behavioral tasks on touchscreen computers. And so, because we're interested in a lower income population, we carefully design the tasks and games so that they can be done with people who are not necessarily literate and who do not necessarily speak English. But certainly this is a more traditional lab experiment. Okay. So to talk about the design, so what we do is we use a variety of methods, I'll talk about those in a second, and we basically implement the stressors or their corresponding control for 7 days consecutively. And so the idea is that the day one picks up the effect of acute stress, right? I'm stressed, it's brief, I'm looking at the behavioral outcomes on that day itself. But then to mimic chronic stress, we're doing it for 7 days consecutively and then also measuring outcomes on that seventh day. And again, I'm gonna put in quotations, chronic stress. Fully acknowledging that this is probably minor in the larger scheme of things, but more than what has been done previously. We measure decision-making using a variety of outcomes. And as I said today in this presentation, I'm going to focus on temporal discounting. So what we're using is the MPL, multiple priceless method, where individuals are choosing between amounts on a sooner date and a later date, right? So they're making a choice based on time, where the time frames are today versus 2 weeks, today versus 4 weeks from today, and 2 weeks versus 4 weeks from today. Okay? And what we do is, because there's been kind of this acknowledgement in the literature that certainly domains matter, especially when we think of poverty, it's often about losing things as well as effort, we do it over three different domains. So first is the more traditional, I think more consistent with the literature, gains domain, where people are given an endowment, and then they're basically choosing between always 400 shillings earlier. So in this time period, 400 shillings is about $4, about daily wage for this sample. So it's 400 shillings earlier versus an amount that ranges between 340 and 1600 shillings later. Okay. The second one is a losses framing, where we give them an endowment, but now everything is framed as losses. So you're going to get this endowment, and then we tell you, okay, you're going to lose 400 shillings versus 340 to 1,600 shillings later. And then the last is we develop an effort-based task that we hope can be easily mobilized. And the idea is that now you're making a choice between effort for the same amount of money. So irrespective, you get if you complete the effort task, you get 500 shillings in a month, but the difference is you either have to make 2 phone calls at the earlier date versus an amount ranging between 1 and 12 phone calls at the later date. Okay, so let me talk about my stressors. So today I'm going to focus on 2. One is what we're calling a psychosocial stressor. Okay, this is the TSST, the Trier Social Stress Task. In it, basically, you are brought into a room with a group of 4 participants, and you're either subject to a control or stress treatment, where the stress treatment is basically a mock job interview. So basically, you come in, you're in this group, you're told you have to give a speech in front of everyone. It's a mock job interview. You will be scored, and everyone looks at you sternly. Okay. In addition, you're also told that you have to, and you actually do, an arithmetic task where basically you go, you are given a starting number, and you have to count backwards in intervals. And what makes this, I think, especially stressful is everyone has to do this in English, which is not necessarily easy. And the enumerators are very stern and correct you. So if you make a mistake in the arithmetic task, you have to start over and you have to do it correctly. Okay. In contrast, the control treatment still has the aspect of speaking in front of others, but it's much more low-key. So you're describing yourself, you have an easy and forgiving mental arithmetic task, so you start at a number and you go upwards in like nice intervals of 10. And the enumerators like smile at you, comfortable, you can talk in either English or Swahili, and so it still has that public speaking component but without the stress. And you simply get paid for being there. So due to the social nature of the tasks, the treatments are going to vary across sessions. And so for this sample, we have 268 participants, again, coming from informal settlements in Kibera. And remember, we see them both on day 1 and on day 7, right? The second stressor I'm presenting today is what I'm going to call the neurobiological stressor, and that's hydrocortisone. And so hydrocortisone is a pill, or sometimes you guys will have seen it as a cream, that you can apply that results in the release of cortisol in your body, which is often referred to as like the primary stress hormone. Okay, so this is a pill that you can have, as I show in the picture. And so either the treatment is that you get 20 mg of hydrocortisone, or the placebo, or the control is a placebo, and because you can't tell the difference between these 2 pills, we can randomize within a session. Okay. And so for this sample, we have 317 participants across that 1-week period. Okay, so first, I'm going to present our manipulation checks, because I'll mention later we have 2 other stressors that did not successfully stress people out. So here we're going to look at the effects of the TSST, and so what our measures are of stress is salivary cortisol as well as self-reported stress. And so here what I've done is I'm focusing on the treatment groups, and that black line is normalizing based on their pre-stressor baseline. And so what I see here is that the TSST has effects both in this acute stress and the chronic stress condition, where what we see is it's a short-lived effect. So the stressor is implemented right before time 0. So 0 is immediately after the stressor. And what we see is that within the first 50 minutes after that stressor, people are experiencing increases in salivary cortisol, as well as increases in self-reported stress. Okay? And qualitatively, they are different for acute and chronic conditions, but those differences are not statistically significant. Okay. So if we think about the TSST has an effect, but it's certainly short-lived within the first 50 minutes, and it's affecting both salivary cortisol as well as self-reported stress. Hydrocortisone has slightly different effects. So if I look at on this left side, this is salivary cortisol, where I'll point out the axes are completely different. So here are my axis goes up to 10. For my hydrocortisone, the axis goes up to 60, so huge effects on salivary cortisol, where not only is the effect on salivary cortisol statistically significant, but they are statistically different between the acute and chronic condition, right? So we can see that the increase in cortisol is less, statistically less, in the chronic condition than the acute condition. However, this does not translate to increases in self-reported stress. So on that right panel, again, it's normalized for time zero for their baseline measure, and we find that self-reported stress does not increase for either group on either day. Okay. So when we think about, when I'm going to present the results, really we should be thinking about it, okay, the TSST was successful in having, you know, smaller but significant effects on both cortisol and self-reported stress in the beginning of those sessions, whereas hydrocortisone had effects through large effects on cortisol, but not self-reported stress. Okay. Unfortunately, these still did not work out well. Okay, so I apologize for the notation. So my main equation of interest is kind of regressing my outcome. So because we have every individual for 7 days, it's outcome at the individual eye level for day T, where we're looking at, nice, it's such a big room, the treatment effect on day one, we're controlling for day seven, and then we're also looking at that kind of interaction between day seven and treatment. Okay, and so when we're thinking about our coefficients of interest, beta one really captures the effect of acute stress on whatever particular outcome. Beta 3, the way we've specified this, captures the effect of chronic stress, or that day 7 of stress, on any particular outcome. So we're going to look at, when I present my results, it'll be beta 1, beta 3, and then of course to test whether acute and chronic stress differ, it's going to be a test of equality of those two coefficients. Okay, so first, to focus on temporal discounting, I'm presenting just the non-parametric results. So what's nice is we have tons of individual level choice data. And so we're looking at the likelihood, the effect of each stressor on the likelihood that they choose a later amount of money. Okay, so this is just simply pooling all that data, saying do they choose that later amount of money? We're pretty much 7 choices out of 8, that later amount of money was greater than what they could have received sooner. Okay, and so what we see is kind of across kind of each domain, so gains, losses, and that effort test, we see that if you're exposed in the stress condition, so day one captures beta one, the treatment effect for the acute condition, day seven is the treatment effect for the chronic condition, we're seeing that statistically significant effect sizes that are large in magnitude and suggest that treatment significantly decreases the likelihood that you choose that later choice. So we're interpreting this as increasing temporal discounting. You're discounting the future at a greater rate. Okay. Very similarly, we look at the TSST, right? So simply looking at the likelihood that you choose that later amount of money for every single choice. And again, we're seeing really consistent evidence across, I think, all but one coefficient that stress decreases the likelihood that you choose that larger later amount of money, so increasing temporal discounting. And what's notable here is this difference in the p-value is testing whether the coefficient on beta 1, day 1, is equal to the coefficient on day 7, beta 3, and we find that these effect sizes are significantly different for the losses and effort domain, though I should note the results are in the opposite direction. Okay. Next, what we do is we take this raw data that we have, and we can use it to estimate present bias and intertemporal discounting. And so here, when we think about present bias, the idea is that I think about today very differently than anything in the future. And so beta less than 1 indicates that you're present biased, and delta captures the fact that you discount the future kind of at this consistent rate, and so delta less than 1 indicates that you discount the future exponentially. One thing that's a bit different about this study, so if you're thinking about the literature, is that we're actually going to take into account risk parameters and loss aversion parameters. So what we do is we modify the Tanaka et al. Task, where they have a number of lotteries over gains, over losses, and over mixed lotteries. And using that data alone, we can create individual level estimates for the curvature parameter, so right kind of risk preferences, as well as this loss aversion parameter lambda, and actually take that into account when we then estimate this beta and delta. So while like, even though I'm gonna show you kind of the beta deltas, understand that there's this other set of stuff happening. And so that's why I call it a two-step maximum likelihood. We're first using the risk data to estimate sigma lambda, and then we're feeding that into the beta delta. Okay, I was told I do not have as much time, so I'm gonna summarize quickly. So here what I've provided is, again, the similar tables that look at the beta deltas for gains and losses, and then the sigma, the curvature parameter, and lambda from the risk task. And so with hydrocortisone, what we're finding is only that there is that hydrocortisone increases risk lovingness, so kind of a higher sigma value on day 7, though admittedly that difference is not statistically significant from day 1. For the TSST, we find that on day 7, so if we look at the gains domain only, we find that in the gains domain, people are more present bias, so a decrease in your beta parameter only on day 7, and that there are certainly differences between the acute and chronic condition based off of this p-value. Apologies for rushing, but I'm happy to talk about this at the end. So to summarize, right, we have these two studies, and these two stressors, and we find consistently that both stressors have significant effects on discounting in the sense that you're much less likely to choose a larger later mount in the future. Once we take those risk preferences into account, we are finding that chronic stress only through the TSST has an effect by increasing peasant bias, so a lower beta, but only in those monetary gains domain. Now, I'm gonna say this with like really suggestive evidence that perhaps maybe stress is contributing towards the persistence of poverty through the effects on temporal discounting, but I think I should acknowledge that there's two kind of limitations to this result. One is that I think our beta delta parameters are messy, there are large standard errors, and so I wouldn't say it with as much confidence as I would with the discounting results. And the second is that I think when we're thinking about chronic stress, I should be upfront about the fact that, you know, while we do stress people for 7 days in a row, these are really minor stressors, especially given perhaps the population of interest, right? So I always get the question, is this ethical? And to be ethical and be able to do this with this population, these are relatively minor stressors. And I think that underscores our results. So just as a last thing, I wasn't able to talk about everything, so I will upfront say that we do not find significant effects on our other behavioral outcomes, certainly not self-efficacy, and very small effects on executive control, but only in a particular group. We run other stressors, so we run an economic stressor where it's really about money, as well as a physical stressor, the cold presser task, and we find that they don't even have effects on stress to begin with, which is why I haven't included them in the paper. Okay, thank you so much for your time. I think I can take questions if anyone has them.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I was wondering if you did any comprehension checks when people are, for example, choosing between different lotteries, if they understand, like if they're doing preference reversals, or if they understand how these different probabilities.
So we certainly have a proportion of the population that struggle with these tasks, but what is notable is that they're not different between stressor or treatment groups. So we did look, especially with the time preferences, if there's like these role reversals or multiple switches, and we don't find that treatment is affecting those differentially. But yes, it does underscore results where there is a certain amount of I want to say multiple switchers or not consistent with the law of demand that just exists. Yeah. Yep.
Prachi, so the point you made towards the end about the need for ethical reasons to limit the amount of stress that you induce makes perfect sense, but of course it raises questions about whether what we learned from your study is informative about the kinds of real stresses people face. Have you done any efforts to try to benchmark things, like compare the level of stress you're able to induce with the level of stress when someone loses a spouse or the harvest fails or they lose a job?
That's a great idea. We haven't done that, but we do have data. So we have a bunch of chronic life stressors data, as well as I think Johannes has a variety of data from other place sources with salivary cortisol that we could use. Thank you. That's a great suggestion.
I wonder if you've closely looked at the mechanism of operation in that is money perceived as a compensation or a way of reducing stress, or is stress looked at as a way of as changing the thinking processes, and those are they may be working together, or they may be, you know, two different processes going on.
Mm-hmm. So they get paid both for participating and for kind of their choices. I don't think I have a good answer for how we can separate that, other than the fact that we tried to keep the money aspect as similar as possible in the treatment and the control groups. So we calibrated our payments so that in expectation, treatment and control groups were getting exactly the same payouts. And so I think in framing it, I would say that, okay, it's there, but it shouldn't be the difference between the two groups, unless there's something going on psychologically. Yeah.
So in the science paper that Johannes has with Ernst Fehr, I think they look what happens with rainfall shocks raise your cortisol levels, right? And what it does to time preferences as well. Is it similar, what it does, you know, if you benchmark in this sense, so a rainfall shock raises your cortisol in your saliva by X, do you find comparable things?
I think that's similar to Dan's point, and I think it's something we need to do. Exactly. I think that's something that we can easily do and just haven't yet. But thank you.
Because I guess that was the reason you're doing this is to, because presumably rainfall shocks do other things than stress you, and you want to kind of decompose, right?
Yeah, and I think in terms of thinking about causal evidence, of course we would be, I think it would be much more appealing to look at chronic stress in a natural experiment setting, but kind of everything that we could think of about that we would argue affects chronic stress affects a variety of other outcomes, including income. And so even though I think those causal studies are also very interesting, I think we're thinking of it as this decomposes the effect of stress, where you can primarily point to stress, and it's kind of to be taken into account with those other studies where the natural experiments do multiple things. Yeah.
Thanks, Prachi.
Thank you so much.